الحمد لله، إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. أما بعد، إخواني أخواتي، dear brothers and sisters, in the last couple of weeks, we talked about the problem of people. Some people will be losing their faith at the end of time because of these trials and tribulations that will take place at the end of time. And today, we would like to share another piece of guidance from the Sunnah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about nifaq, hypocrisy, that will take place. It will be obvious at the end of time. And the reason we talk about this unpleasant subject is that a mu'min has to recognize evil. You cannot protect yourself against evil. You cannot stay away from evil if you don't recognize it. You need to recognize what is being able to distinguish between khair and shar. How can you stay away from shar, evil, if you don't recognize it? And that was the hikmah, the wisdom that Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman shared. He said people used to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about khair. I used to ask him about evil. مَخَافَةَ أَنْ يُدْرِكَنِي مَخَافَةَ أَنْ يُدْرِكَنِي, out of fear that it might overtake me. I want to protect myself. That was his philosophy. That was his wisdom, Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman. I'm saying this because some people might feel like we don't want to keep talking about these subjects all the time. They are important because you know what's going on around us, Ikhwan, and we need to know, increase our knowledge, and protect ourselves, protect our faith, protect our families. So today, as I said, I will try to focus on the problem of hypocrisy, sharing with you two ahadith again from the Sunnah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the first one talked, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam talked about three trials. I'm not sure about their interpretation. But I am interested in the last one. Because in the last one, there is a clear guidance that is given, that was given to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in this hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Umar himself, radiallahu anhu, said, we were sitting with the messenger of Allah. كُنَّ جُلُوسًا مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَتَكَلَّمَ عَنِ الْفِتَنِ. ذكر فتنة الأحلاس وفتنة السراء وفتنة الدهيماء. هذه الأشياء خاضوا فيها الناس، تروح للإنترنت تجد عجيب وغريب، كل واحد يشرح لك فتنة الدهيماء ولا السراء ولا أحلاس على طريقته. ولا أريد أن أستعمل آرائي الشخصية. I don't want to use my personal interpretation. People have different interpretations for these three trials that are found in this hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood. I am interested in the last part of this hadith. So fitna al-ahlas could be translated as the fitna of those who stay at home. There could be a fitna in the future where people, they have to stay home. They have nothing to do, or they are afraid or scared. They stay at home. Allahu a'lam. The second one, fitna al-sarra, the joy of happiness. What kind of fitna? Allahu a'lam. The third one, he said al-duhayma, the little black one. I'm interested in the last part of this hadith. He said, ثم فتنة الدهيماء لا تدع أحدا من هذه الأمة إلا لطمته. مشكلة، يعني كل واحد راح يتأثر بهذه الفتنة. إلا لطمته لطمة. فإذا قيل انتهت أو انقضت تمادت. يصبح الرجل فيها مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا. حتى يصير الناس إلى فسطاطين. هذه المشكلة. حتى يصير الناس إلى فسطاطين. قال فسطاط إيمان لا نفاق فيه. إيمان خالص. ناس مؤمنين ولا فيهم ولا منافق واحد. هذا جانب. والقسم الثاني من الناس قال وفسطاط نفاق لا إيمان فيه. كلهم منافقين، ما فيهم ولا واحد مؤمن، وضع خطير جدا. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا في آخر الزمن، ونحن في آخر الزمن، في أدلة كثيرة على أنه نحن في آخر الزمن. قال فإذا كان ذاكم، فإذا صارت هذه القسمة واضحة، هؤلاء أهل إيمان لا نفاق فيهم، لا منافق فيهم، كلهم ناس مؤمنين خالصين، وهؤلاء الفريق الثاني كلهم منافقين. قال فإذا كان ذاكم فانتظروا الدجال من يومه أو غده، يعني هذا الأمر يحصل قبل ظهور الدجال، عندما تنقسم الأمة إلى قسمين، مش كافر ومؤمن، لا، أمة محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام، الأمة الإسلامية تنقسم إلى قسمين، وهذا خطير طبعا، خطير جدا، لأنه فيش منطقة رمادية، لا بد تتخذ موقف، يا مع أهل الإيمان أو مع أهل النفاق، يعني مضطر، راح تضطر تتخذ موقف. فإن this حديث as I said I am not sure about the interpretation of the first part of the hadith. But the second part, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم will be talking about a fitna and he called it a duhayma. He said there will be the little black trial, which will leave none of this ummah without, of this community, without giving him a slap on his face, which means everyone will be affected by it. Nas'Allah salama wa al-afiyah. And he said when people say it's finished, it's over, it's done, it will be extended. So he said during this time, a man will be a believer in the morning and he becomes a disbeliever in the evening. We talked about it in a previous khutbah. But what is, he gave us another extra information in this hadith. He said, so that people will be in two camps. A camp of faith with no hypocrisy in it. Pure faith. No hypocrisy whatsoever, whatsoever. And a camp of hypocrisy with no faith in it. So the problem in this hadith, ya ikhwan, is that some people of this ummah will fall into the problem of hypocrisy. And for sure that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is talking about major hypocrisy, not minor. Minor, with minor hypocrisy, the Muslim is still Muslim. Whenever he talks, he shares a lie. Whenever he gives a promise, he breaks his promise. If he has a disagreement with someone, he will use a very filthy language. This is about behavior and attitude. This is called minor hypocrisy. The person is still Muslim. Yes, these are major problems, major sins. But on the Day of Judgment, he will be treated as a Muslim, as a mu'min who had some issues, maybe. Maybe this person will make tawbah and then he will be fine on the Day of Judgment, right? But Rasulullah in this hadith is talking about major hypocrisy. Why? What's the proof? Because he said during this time, a man will be a believer in the morning and he becomes a disbeliever in the evening. So this is major hypocrisy. There is no doubt about it. And the second problem in this hadith, of course, that people will face extreme trials to the extent that there will be no gray area. This silent majority does not exist anymore. Silent majority does not exist. Those who like to keep quiet and say, I have nothing to do with it, I'll just take care of my family and my business, doesn't exist anymore. Either you choose to be with the camp of faith or with the camp of hypocrisy. Allah salama wa al-afiyah. That's why it's important to know these things and to know the dangers of nifaq and how do you protect yourself. Do you protect your faith from hypocrisy? It's very important that you think about what's going on now. Think that what's going on now, it was many of the things that are happening now are unbelievable. Yani we could not imagine that these things will happen in the future. But now we hear about things happening and we see them with our eyes. It's Allah salama wa al-afiyah. And what is more dangerous, is people are accepting these things nowadays. They feel more comfortable. When evil stays for a long period of time, people start becoming comfortable with evil and they accept it. And it becomes the norm sometimes. If a person says, this is evil, we should not do it, he might look like he's a weird person. Gharib. He's a stranger. Right? Because everyone is doing, you know, what is wrong? And then this person will be like different. You know, what are you talking about? What are you doing? This is very dangerous, ya ikhwan. Anyway, if you want to know خطورة النفاق, the danger of نفاق, there is a piece of guidance, beautiful piece of guidance, because the Quran talked about نفاق and منافقين a lot. But I want you to pay attention to Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the first surah in the Quran, we keep asking Allah to guide us to the straight path. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Every day, right? Every day. Whenever we pray, we make this dua. It's included in Surah Al-Fatiha. So Allah gave us the answer. You just turn the page, and then the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه, هدن, هدن للمتقين. If you are a muttaqi and you're looking for guidance, you'll find it in this book. You find it in this book. And now the first, pay attention to the first 20 verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. The first 20 verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. The first ayah, it's disconnected letters. We don't know their meaning. We know the hikmah behind them, but we don't know their meaning. Alif Lam Mim. You remove this ayah, the next four ayat about al-mu'mineen, the believers, and their qualities. Allah describing the aqidah and the behavior of the believers and their ibadat. The next two verses about the kuffar, the disbelievers. So five plus two, seven. What is left out of 20? 13. 13 verses about al-munafiqeen. Why? Because they confuse you. You don't know how to deal with them. They tell you we are Muslims, we are believers. They tell you we are muslihun. We have a good plan for the ummah, for the community. 13 آية إخوان عن المنافقين. Why? Two verses about the kuffar, because when the kafir tells you I'm a Christian or I'm a Jewish or a Buddhist, so you know how to organize your relationship with him, right? Based on his feedback. He's telling you, I'm kafir, I don't believe in your message, don't believe in your Quran, that's okay. He could be a neighbor, could be a colleague. He could be an enemy who is fighting you. At least you know whom you're dealing with. You know how to organize your relationship with him. But this other person, he's telling you, I'm Muslim. I'm trying to help the community. I'm trying to help the ummah. I'm doing this for the sake of the ummah. And Allah told us about their behavior. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. About munafiqeen. Not kuffar. Munafiqeen. When it is said to them, do not spread corruption in the land, they said, we are only peacemaker. We are reformers. We are people of Islah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them. Of course, he included those who lived during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also every munafiq is included in this ayat, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ مُفْسِدُونَ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Verily, they are the ones who are spreading corruption on the land, but they perceive it not. نسأل الله السلامة والعافية. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفرونه وهو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So dear brothers and sisters, in a different hadith, I promise that I'm going to share two a hadith with you today from the guidance of our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, the sunnah of our Prophet. He talked to us in this second hadith about callers to the gates of hell. دُعَاتٌ عَلَى أَبْوَابِ جَهَنَّمِ. And the problem is, these people, again, they are from the ummah. They are not outsiders. They are from the ummah. In this hadith, حذيفة بن اليمان قال, كنت كان الناس يسألون رسول الله عن الخير وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني. حديث البخاري ومسلم. People used to ask رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم about good things. I used to ask him about evil, out of fear that it might overtake me. Again, I told you need to recognize evil if you want to protect yourself against it. Then Hudhayfa, he started asking Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it is like this description, it's like different stages that the ummah will go through. He said, كُنَّا فِي جَاهِلِيَةٍ وَشَرْ فَجَاءَنَا اللَّهُ بِهَذَا الْخَيْرِ الْخَيْرِ اللي هو الإسلام فَهَلْ بَعْدَ هَذَا الْخَيْرِ مِنْ شَرْ. He said, we were in ignorance and used to practice evil, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon us this good, present good, which is the message of the Quran, the presence of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فهل بعد هذا الخير من شر? He said, will there be any evil after this good? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yes, there will be evil after this khair. And then Hudhayfa ibn Yaman asked him, وهل بعد هذا الشر من خير? فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نعم وفيه دخن يعني مش كامل وهذه المرحلة نعيشها الآن يوجد خير بس مش كامل nothing is perfect we keep saying nothing is perfect and this is true even those who are trying their best and they have good intention trying to help the community sometimes they do things that are not accepted or approved by the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala but these people are still they still have maybe good intention But what is after that is worse. And we need to pay attention to the discussion that took place between Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, will there be any good after this evil? He said, na'am wa fihi dakhan, yes, but it will be tainted. He said, what is tainted? He said, qawmun yahduna bighayri hadi, ta'rifu minhum wa tunkir. He said, there will be people who will be guiding others. So they are Muslims and they're guiding other Muslims. But they guide them with principles other than the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He told him, you're going to look at their actions and you disapprove some of them. Nowadays, we know that. We're very familiar with that. We see things, people يعني, mixing between khair and between shar, between sunnah and bid'ah. And this is something that we are able to see it. And when they do something good, we are supposed to be fair and tell them جزاكم الله خيراً الله يكثر من أمثالكم may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your efforts. But when they do something bad or they go against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are supposed to give them nasiha with hikmah and wisdom, especially if we know that their intention is good. Intention is very important. If we are confident that their intention is good, then we have to use rifq, gentleness and hikmah. With our people. If we know that the person or this group of people have a very evil agenda, then we might need to take a different position against them, right? So al-hikmah huwa wad'u al-shay fi mawdi'ihi. You cannot be soft all the time and you cannot be tough all the time. Sometimes you need to be tough, sometimes you need to be soft. It depends on the situation. But anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said it's tainted. Then he said, وَهَلْ بَعْدَ هَذَا الْخَيْرِ مِنْ شَرْ هُنَا الْخُطُورَةِ هُنَا الْخُطُورَةِ قَالَ نَعَمْ دُعَاةٌ عَلَىٰ أَبْوَابِ جَهَنَّمْ مَنْ أَجَابَهُمْ قَذَفُوهُ فِيهَا قَذَفُوهُ فِي جَهَنَّمْ نسأل الله السلامة والعافية فقال يا رسول الله صفهم لنا صفهم لنا هذا حذيفة يتكلم مع الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام هاي المشكلة الخطورة شو يقول له هاي من جماعتنا هذا قالوا من جلدتنا ويتكلمون بألسنتنا من جلدتنا ويتكلمون بألسنتنا قال فما تنصحني فما تأمرني إن أدركني ذلك قال تلزموا جماعة المسلمين وإمامهم فإن لم يكن لهم إمام الإمام هنا القائد السياسي ليس الإمام في المسجد يعني الخليفة أو القائد السياسي قال تلزموا جماعة المسلمين وإمامهم فإن لم يكن لهم جماعة ولا إمام فاعتزل تلك الفرق كلها ولو أن تعض بجذع شذرة حتى يأتيك الموت وأنت على ذلك يعني تعض بجذع شذرة هو هذه عبارة تسمى مجاز في اللغة العربية المقصود منها أنك تبتعد تحافظ على دينك تبتعد من هؤلاء الفرق كلهم لأصحاب البدع وأصحاب الأفكار الهدامة اللي يريدوا يأخذوك إلى جهنم باسم أسماء ممكن تكون جميلة جداً يمكن واحد يستعمل حب النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام وحب آل البيت ووخذك إلى طريق جهنم فالمشكلة بدها علم الشغلة بدها علم يا أخوان بدها فطانة وفقه وفهم لدين الله عز وجل So حذيفة when he asked him at the end will there be any evil after this good he said yes callers at the gates of جهنم This is what is dangerous here. We're talking because we're talking about people from within our circles. And then Hudhayfa, he said, describe them to us. He said, first, whoever respond to them, they will throw him in Jahannam because of their ideologies, false ideologies. So he said, "Sifhum lana, describe them to us." He said, "They will belong to our community." من جلدتنا ويتكلمون بألسنتنا. And they will speak our language. Of course, language here interpreted into three interpretations. Some ulama, they said, maybe he meant the Arabic language. The other interpretation, any specific language in any specific Muslim community, because Muslim communities will have different languages. But they will be local people. They will be members of that community. The other interpretation, which is more dangerous, they will speak the language of faith. Hey, يتكلموا بالدين, بسم الدين. The language of faith. They might raise the Quran. They might actually talk with a hadith from the sunnah of the messenger of Allah. But the agenda is not clean. The agenda is not clean. It's very dangerous, ikhwan. So here, Hudhayfa was kind of nervous. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, ما تأمرني إن أدرك ذلك? What is your nasiha for me if I reach this time?" He said, "You adhere to the main body of Muslims. You adhere to the main body of Muslims and their imam, their leader, or their chief. If they don't have any group, there is no Muslim, group of Muslims around you, and no leader, then," he said, "اعتزل تلك الفرقة كلها." Stay away from all these sects. Stay away from all these ideologies, false ideologies. Even if you have to bite, and this is metaphorical, يعني it's not metaphorical, it's figurative speech. He said, "Even if you have to bite into the trunk of a tree until death comes to you while you are still in this state." يعني you try to stay away from all these false ideologies and adhere to the Quran and the Sunnah, to your deen, protect yourself, take care of yourself and your family. فنسأل الله السلامة والعافية. That was the نصيحة of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to حذيفة بن اليمان. But it is a very interesting discussion. This hadith is found in Bukhari, by the way, and it is found in Sahih Muslim. The purpose of this hadith, how do we protect ourselves from hypocrisy, nifaq? Right? في بعض الأدعية, أدعية واحد إنسان يدعو بها, اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك, O turner of the hearts, keep my heart firm on your deen. يعني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was the last final messenger. He was promised Jannah. He was the leader of all prophets and messengers, and he used to use his dua, this dua. كان يدعو بهذا الدعاء. الحبيب عليه الصلاة والسلام. أم سلمة تقول, كان أكثر دعائه, اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك. يعني هو الحبيب عليه الصلاة والسلام يدعو بهذا الدعاء ويعلم أمته أنه المسألة خطيرة, مسألة خطيرة. ممكن يعتقد الإنسان أنه ماشي صح, ماشي صح. الآن فتن الأمة تنقسم إلى أقسام. الآن ناس يطلعوا الآن في التلفزيونات, people are talking on TV and social media, and they are speaking nonsense, and you just like, how come he's speaking this language? How come he's, for example, telling the Zionists, go and kill those Muslims in Gaza? Did you imagine that a Muslim would do something like that in the past? That a Muslim will appear in TV, in a TV channel, and he will encourage the Zionists to get rid of the Palestinians? I didn't imagine that this will happen when I was young. But now, at this age, now I'm able to see it. We're able to see them and hear these people speaking this language. نسأل الله السلامة والعافية. اللهم اغفر لنا وتوب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم ارحم ضعفنا واجبر كسرنا ويسر أمرنا. ردنا جميعا إلى كتابك وسنة نبيك عليه الصلاة والسلام. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. الحمد لله رب العالمين.